Hey, good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good to see y'all this morning. Glad you're here. I got to look at my roadmap for a second. Hang on. All right, now I know where I'm going.
Thank you.
updates of some big things going on campus, remind everybody that next Sunday, we're going to be combining services due to the crowds. So at 9 o'clock rather than 8 o'clock, and then this service will move to 9, okay? So our service times will be 9 and 10:30. So please remember that, come just a little bit earlier next week, and hopefully between that first service and this one, it'll be a little bit better, okay? So remember, combining services, 9 a.m. and then 10:30. Hey, for all the kids here this morning, your moms, there's a special note from Miss Rihanna out of the foyer for you. You need to go by and read that. There's some instructions about getting a sign and having some fun. She's trying to keep ministry going during this time. So go by and read that if you don't mind. And there's some instructions there on what to do. And just a little thought at the end for you and your children to enjoy during this crazy, crazy time. So please go by and do that, and I appreciate all she's doing. Hey, also just want to remind you that during this time, due to all the situations right now, there's still no rentals on the church facilities at this time. We wish we could, but right now due to cleaning and all that, we just can't. So please understand that and do the best we can under these circumstances, but right now, still no rentals or activities on the church facilities during this time. Hey, just been asked to announce this, remind you to also, please help us. You know, we're trying to get everything to spread and to clean, but safe distancing is up to you. So you determine how close you can get and not get, but make sure that when you leave and things like that, if you find a good safe distance, and do that. Hey, remind you that tonight we have a special time with Pastor Eric and Miss Amanda on the parking lot. Bring your lawn chair, bring your drinks. We'll have ice and cups. You bring your drink. Also, for moms and dads, my Amy Ice will be here. Listen carefully. From 6 to 7, they have another appointment at 8, so they're going to be here from 6 to 7. And we'll be handing out tickets for you. You get a free Miami Ice. So you can do that. Then about 7:15, we'll have a little fireworks show. So I hope you'll hang around, come by, tell Eric and Amanda that you pray for them. They are still trying to leave right now. The country is closed, or the airport's closed. So as soon as they get to go, they're headed that way. They are going to Guatemala to do what they're, there's a little bit of change. You're just going to be staying for a while, but they're still headed to the same place to do the same thing. So come by this afternoon, let them know. Pray for them in heaven. Hey, you know our fireworks standing out front. Remind you to go by and pick up some fireworks. We did last night and outside with our grandson. Also remind you that if you buy or donate, either one, tickets are going to a bucket and there'll be a grand prize draw. Now listen carefully. Everybody listen. I asked a person last night, do y'all fly to Hawaii? And they said, yes. So, hey, I'm in. So I'll be buying fireworks every 30 minutes. Amen. So go buy and buy fireworks. And you're supporting the youth, their ministry, and all that they do. So, hey, please go by and do that. Hey, if you didn't know the week is Jonathan Johnson. And if you need anything, certainly call the church or call us or call him if you need anything. Hey, some prayer requests real quick. Like I failed to mention this morning. How many of y'all remember Lee and Brad Plunch? I remember him. He is on life support in Nashville. He's only about 54 years old. Miss Anita worked with our preschool here for a long time. So please pray for Brad Crunch. He is clinging to life in the morning. They're going to take him off the respirator and see how things go. So please pray for that family, sweet, precious family. Their son Will grew up in our ministry here. And so pray for that family, okay? And Rich continues to need our prayers. Sue Martin, of course, by the way, Sue did make it back to Florence. She's with her daughter here, so she is in town. So we'll start doing some ministry today. We're going to be careful. We don't want to break any policies today, but we will start trying to minister to that thing a little bit more directly, okay? Man, we're glad you're here this morning. I'm looking forward to sharing the message today. Some things I hope that will help you during this time to kind of maybe come to where, whatever in the world's going on, we make some understanding of what we need to do as Christians, okay? Hey, let's pray. Father, we love you. We want to certainly pray today for Brad and Anita Clonks. We love them so much. We appreciate who they are and what they stand for. And during this very difficult hour, I pray your grace and your peace will be with that family in Nashville. I pray for Sue Martin as she continues to recover and prepare for the inevitability of her life. But God, give that family grace. And Amy Ritchie, as she has got to go through some very difficult days and tests and things. So be with them. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the Holy Spirit that is even speaking in these days. May we have hearts to hear and are to obey and ears to listen. So, Father, thank you for this time we have. We love you and we praise for us. In Jesus' name we pray. And all the church said, amen. Amen.
That night, the kids would get those Roman candles. And lie and hold them in our hand and shoot them at each other. Now, I'm not encouraging y'all to do that, especially you kids. Okay? I'm not encouraging that. I'm just saying those things hurt. When they hit, they hurt.
Back in, yes, sir.
Just, you know, fun times. Of course, we set the woods on fire one time with those when I was a kid. But speaking of fire, you know, I think in our country today, we need to start a fire in our own lives, in our hearts and in our souls, and ask God to come and do a work in us today. We need it more than ever in our country today. We need it more than ever in our lives today. Because, hey, is anybody out there think it's easy to serve the Lord today? If you did, just raise your hand. Anybody? It's not easy serving God today. It's not. You know, the Word tells us that if a brother slaps you on one cheek, you're supposed to turn around and slap the other one. That ain't how I think. I'm asking God to help me with that every day. Because what stuff is going on in our world today, brother, it's hard. It's hard to listen and to hear people scream and yell and just be evil in your face and then have to reach out with the love of God and try to tell them Jesus loves them. It's hard today. It's hard to have a brother knock you down and then try to be Jesus to them and reach your hand down and pick them up. It's hard. And we need Jesus to set our fire in our hearts today. Let's ask him today to do the work in our lives. Come on.
Here in your love, here in your love.
within us, so that we can be Jesus in our world today, so that we can be salt and light, so that we can bring peace instead of hate, so that we can bring love and joy and kindness and goodness and faithfulness, so that we can bring self-control, those fruits of the Spirit that you give us, Lord, and light us up inside, Father, so that we can share those with our world today. Bless your word today, Father. Bless the one that brings it, Lord. Just, Father, just pour our blessings on us today. Every family that's represented here today, Father, make yourself known to us today. In Christ's name, I pray. Amen.
Well, thank you, Pastor, and all the church said. Amen. Heavy Bibles. Find your way to 2 Samuel. We'll continue to talk about worship this morning, and the message is going to be just a little bit heavy, so y'all please hang in there with me. And if you have a pencil, you might want to write some reference scriptures down, because of some things that we're just going to kind of touch on today, and where we are in culture and what's going on. I'm being very careful about what I say, because I really don't know what to say, and I'll show you that scripture in just a moment. What do you do when you don't know what to say? And David in 2 Samuel helps us with that just a little bit. Had heard a little cute story the other day. I thought you might enjoy it. I heard this guy, he said, you know, when I was working, I lived paycheck to paycheck. Anybody here been about that? And he said, now that I'm retired, I just live from deposit to deposit. Amen. So I just want to say, wherever you are, whatever is going on in your life, I'm glad that the Father knows it and that he is blessing us. Hey, you know, the Bible says, speak to those things that are honorable. I just want to say congratulations to Ron and Grace Ann Hall. I was giving trouble out of the hall. They have been married 33 years. Thank y'all for the testimony and the way you do. We all say thank you to God for all they do in the life of our children. Ron, especially Grace Ann, man, just don't know what we do about people like this. So congratulations to you guys, and the Lord bless you and give you another 133 or how many breaks you can. I hear you. But hey, thank y'all for doing it and showing us how to do it. So again, the message today is going to be a little bit heavy. We've been talking about building the church. Jesus is building his church. What's he building it on? Well, we talked about lordship. And then I really did not intend for this thing about worship to get this long, but it seems like the more I deal with it, the more I feel like I just need to say it. So we've been dealing with this idea of real biblical worship. What is biblical worship? It's more than singing a song in the church, say amen. It's more than clapping hands, it's more than raising. It's a heart relationship with God. And now, that doesn't mean those things don't matter. They do. But worship is when you and I surrender and we totally praise and worship God. And we talked about first week that the worship involves this. It's just the reason God created us, Psalms 150. We talked last week in detail about how worship is a response to the goodness of God. God's been good, and so how do we respond? We worship, and we praise him, and we thank him. Well, today we're going to deal with one on this subject, and I want you to hear, I really want you to hear what I'm going to say today. That is, it renews my spirit. It's reason we worship, the response, but notice this, it renews our spirit. We live in a world today that as Pastor Keith said, man, it's just getting harder and harder to stand up for those core faith beliefs and to stand up for Christ. And to speak the truth without somebody spitting on you or hollering at you or criticizing you or condemning you. And so it's getting very difficult. Well, there's a story in the Old Testament, and it's a very difficult story. 2 Samuel 12, verse number 15, is when David had an adulterous affair. And the Bible says, doesn't use your name, it says, with the wife of Uriah. We all know the story, David and Uriah. I personally think that it was a sexual assault. It wasn't anything on Bathsheba's part, it was him. He took her, the Bible says. And so the Bible says as a result of that relationship, she became pregnant. And so they had come up with a scheme, a plan, what are we going to do? And so David decided that he would kill Bathsheba's husband, his friend. Matter of fact, if you read the Bible, he was one of the captains of the army. And so anyhow, they devised a plan, David did, that when they go to the battle, they would retreat, leave him there, and Uriah was killed. So it is sometimes later, we don't know how long, we know it's at least 9 months, because the baby now is coming to you. So we know it's at least 9. I think it's a little bit further than that. Probably 12 or 13. We don't know, because Nathan confronted David in chapter 12. And so some time has elapsed. And so it's come time for the baby to be born. And then something goes wrong. Something goes terribly, terribly wrong. And whatever doctor or medical person they had then, they realized that this child's life was in critical care. It looked like that the child may not live. So remember how it started, by the way, did I say this? I'll talk about this in just a moment, that, you know, some of the things we face in life. By the way, how many of y'all say that life can be hard? Would you agree?
Amen.
Life can be hard, can it? It really can. Life can be, here's the word, life can just be heavy. Life can be a heavy weight situation. So if we're not careful, when we go through this, life can just become heavy. I want to use the word, it can just become hard. And David's facing a very heavy, difficult situation. But let me say this, it's also a haunting time for David, because David knows the reason he's in the situation is because of the sin in his life. So it's been very hard for David, been very heavy, but it's become a very haunting time when David is now looking back and thinking, what have I done? And we can go into a lot of things about that, but other than this, it's a very hard time, very heavy. David's very haunted by the fact of what he's done. He had an adulterous affair. He had a friend killed. And now this weight is just heavy. And I just want to say to you today, church, we're living in some very heavy, hard times. I just want to ask the question, why do we have problems in life? Well, I just want to make two or three things about this, if we could. I think about in life, when things get heavy, it's because the problem, but also normally, a lot of times our problems are caused by people. Did you know wherever there's people, there's problems, and all the church said? I don't care if it's at a ball game, I don't care if it's at a church, I don't care if it's at your family reunion. If there's people there, you're probably going to have problems. So David is experiencing this very haunting, heavy time in his life, and he realized some of the problems he's facing as a result of some of the decisions that he made. As long as you live, you're going to have problems. People are difficult. Here's one, pain. And I'm going to make a point here, so stay with me. David's involved in all three of those right now. The problems of life, the people that he's affected negatively and positively, and then the pain that he knows he has personally caused. And so David is at a very difficult moment in his life. Then I want to say a fourth one here, and I'll explain this at the end of the message, if you'll just hang on with me. That word is prophecy. What do you mean by that, Pastor? Well, there's some things that are going to happen, and as your pastor, many people are crossing, hey, Pastor, when are you going to come to the pulpit and address all this stuff? Well, I'll say about that, just listen very carefully. There's some things we can pray about and change, and there's some things we cannot. Prophetically speaking, if God's will is going to happen, and all the church said, you can't change the sovereign will of God. David prayed, but it didn't change because it was God's will. Somebody said last week, and they were full heart in. Man, Pastor, we need to have a prayer meeting and pray this COVID-19 out of here. And I said, well, that's a good idea, unless this is the working of the hand of God. How do you know that God's not using this? I don't know. I really don't. I'm going to take the message. I don't know the answer. Totally. I know some things we need to do, but there's some things prophetic. But I don't know that God had to open a prophetic door to the heavens. And there's some things taking place on earth today that they're just hard. You know, I wish I had a magic wand to change it all, but we can't. But there's some things happening today. I was speaking to somebody the other day and said, can you believe how much the world has changed in the last year? To which they responded, no, how about the last 2 months? Man, the last 2 months, things, our life has dramatically, not March, whenever, when COVID, maybe it's even gotten worse since then. I just asked the question, is there something prophetically going on in the world with all the problems and people and pain that we're facing? It is maybe God up to something prophetic, and that you and I need to understand that that's his will, and by faith, receive that, and then what can we do about it? Well, let me show you in the Bible. See, so David has had this affair. Uriah's dead. The baby's sick, and he's asking God to spare the child's life. Judy and I had a miscarriage several years ago. We met back with some supper last night, and because I was in Princess Message, I just said, hey, Mom, how old would the little man be today? She said, 25 years old. If he had lived, he'd be 26 actually today, or this year. And so, you know, we got a lot of investment in heaven. So listen to David's heart about a child that he had in a difficult situation, and now it's about to die. Listen to his heart, would you? Verse, now we're talking about worship. Okay? The fact I haven't heard anything about worship, but this has come up. Look at it. 2 Samuel 12:15. Then Nathan departed to his house. Nathan confronted him about the sin. But look at this. And the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife bore to David. Whose wife? It's like God used a little zinger right there. You do remember. You do know why this is going on. That lady that sat in your child, that was another man's wife. Wow. Now, the read the Bible. And the Lord struck the child. Who struck the child? Who? The Lord struck the child. Pretty tough, isn't it? The Lord struck the child, that Uriah's wife bore to David, and it came very evil. So we don't think it's a baby involved. We think it's a little bit down the road, maybe. We don't know. Scholars, it's very debated. We're not sure. David at that point, look what David did when he heard that the child was ill and about to die. So look what David did. So therefore, David pleaded with God for the child. He pleaded. That word pleaded in Hebrews, he begged God. He begged God. By the way, this is the psalmist of Israel. This is a friend of God. This is a man who was after God's own heart. And he pleaded with God for the child, and David fasted and went in and lay all night on the earth. So the elders of the house arose and went to him to raise him up. They were concerned about him. He was fasting and praying. And the Bible says they went in to get him up. David, verse 17, so the elders of the house arose and went to raise him up on the ground, but he would not, and nor did he eat food with them. Then on the seventh day it came to pass that the child died, because in verse 15 it says God struck the child. You need to keep that in mind. Then on the seventh day it came to pass that the child died, and the servants of David were afraid to tell him. Notice this verse, this is very interesting, that the child was dead, for they said, indeed, while the child was alive, we spoke to him, and he would not heed our voice. How could we tell him the child is dead? Well, listen to this. He may do himself harm. Well, this is a pretty tough passage. Would you agree? The point here is David suicidal? Well, this is a tough, heavy passage. What are we going to do? If we tell him, he may harm himself. When David saw that the servants were whispering, David perceived that the child was dead. Therefore, David said to the servants, is the child dead? And they said, he is. So David arose from the ground, washed and anointed himself, and changed his clothes. And he went to the house of the Lord, and, would you say it with me out loud, church? He what? He what? Worship. In the midst of all this pain, in the midst of all these hard situations, God struck the child. David knew his sin now had been exposed, the nation of Israel, the people he hurt, and now the pain is almost unbearable, so much so that the servant said, if we tell him, what will he do to himself? Wow. But David, hearing the news, got up, and the first thing he did, he'd been on the ground 7 days. So he smelled by now, stinking, and he anointed himself and changed his clothes, and he went to the house of, and he worshiped, and he went to his own house and requested that they bring food. Set before him. And the servant said to him, what are you doing? You lost your mind. That's really what the text implies here. David, when the child was alive and you were praying for him, you didn't eat. Now the child is dead. You got up and you washed and changed his clothes. You even went to church. Have you lost your mind? What are you doing, David? David gives a biblical explanation, and I really want you to see this. What is this that you've done? You fasted, you wept for the child when he was alive, but when the child died, you arose and ate food. And this is what David said. While the child was alive, I fasted and wept, for I said, who can tell? Question mark. Who knows the sovereign will of God? David is admitting, I didn't know. The reason I was praying and fasting was that God would save his life, but God had will. God struck the child. Church, you cannot get away from that. And David prayed that God did not answer his prayers, even though he fasted, even though he prayed, and the Spirit said, hey, we need to have a prayer meeting, and we do. But at the end of the day, there's something prophetically going on in the world today that no matter how much we pray, how much we fast, God's will is going to be done on some level. We need to start asking that question. Has there a prophetic door open in the heavens and God is dealing with the world? Can I say this? I can see a one world coming because of this pandemic. If it gets worse, eventually the leaders of all nations are going to gather together and they're going to force medical issues in order to bring everybody into conformity because people are dying. I can see that easily happening, and out of the shadows steps a Savior we call him the Antichrist. You don't see that? Then you better look. I'm just asking, has a door open, prophetic in the heavens, where God is doing something mysteriously, but yet his will. So David said, I don't know God's will in this situation. That's what he said. He said, while the child was alive, I passed him well, and I said, who can tell that the Lord may be gracious to me, that the child may live? And then he gives this beautiful, beautiful answer. This is carried. But now, he is dead. I cannot change that. Here's what I can do. Why should I fast? Can I bring him back? And the answer to that in Hebrew is no. And here's what he said. Since I can't bring him back, I will get ready to go to him, but he shall never return to me. Wow. I'll say it backwards. Wow. Would you agree with me that's a tough story? It is. Guys, I don't know if it gets any personal tougher right there. Well, a man having to realize because of his sins, God has judged him, and the baby lost his life. Brother Ron, how does that all work out? I don't know. God's will. God's plan. So let me show you about four or five stages here that we all may be going through, and hopefully we'll get to this stage where David did. Number one, notice verse 16. Notice David's trials are his worry. In verse 16, David is worried. David pleaded with the Lord for the child. This is God's friend. This is the psalmist. This is the one who's singing. And David is in this trial, and David is absolutely beside himself, according to the servants, because he can't change the situation. By the way, listen, there's some things you can't change. There's some things you can't make better. There's some things you just got to say, God, I'm going to have to turn to you and trust you and get in that moment. But Lord, right now, where I am. Does anybody in here, and you don't raise your hand, anybody not have any worries? Anybody not have any situations or anxieties or concerns in life? Anybody not have something that you went to bed with last night and you thought about it and you woke up with it this morning and it's still in your mind? Probably so. But David, worry. Life can be hard. Life can be difficult. The Bible says he therefore pleaded. He begged God for the child, and he went in and laid down, as the picture of prosperity, all night long. And they came and said, Dad, you need some food. He said, I'm not going to eat until I know what God's going to do. And so the Bible says he was in this fretting situation where he didn't know what to do. Number two, look at verse 17. Not only David is worried, but notice that David now is weary. Bible says, so the elders of the house rose and went to raise him up. They didn't think he could get up. David's worry now has turned into weariness. He is tired. When I went through some severe counseling in Atlanta, Georgia, and I need some more. Not the church. There was a word called H-A-L-T. And they taught us that when you're in these four areas, you're the most dangerous. Hungry, angry, lonely, or tired. Don't write that word down, Paul. When you're in one of those situations, you usually make an impulsive decision. You do something that just you shouldn't do. Hungry, angry, lonely, tired. So here's David. He's worried, and now he was weary. He's so tired that they don't think he can literally get up off the ground. And let me say right now, the world will weigh you down. It will. Your problems and people and pain, after a while, it just keeps on and keeps on and keeps on. And David is fasting and praying, doing everything he knows spiritually to do. And maybe you're doing the same thing and you're looking around and say, hey, Pastor, nothing has changed. So there's worry, there's weariness. For time's sake, I'm looking at verse 18. Notice he gets wounded. And then the baby dies. Child dies. And on the seventh day, it came to pass, the child died. Bad things happen in this world, things that you don't plan on, things that you pray against, you wish wouldn't have happened. Divorce happens. Cancer happens. Death happens. And we think, why did this terrible, catastrophic thing happen in my life? And David's going back to this holy situation that he has caused. I promise you, we'll get to a good point in a minute. Hang with me. And so David's very wounded. The child died, and he said, hey, is he dead? Life can cause worry, it can cause. cause you to be weary, it can wound you. You go through trials, you get tired, and then it almost like the whole scenario changes. Just, hey, ride in the car. I think it was Friday. And we had Jackson in the back seat. He's 4 years old. I'll say that again. He's 4 years old. So Judy and I are having a conversation, and Auburn comes up. And we say something about, hey, yay, War Eagle. And he says, oh, no. Roll Tide, Alabama's number one. He is 4 years old. I just put him out of the car and let him walk home by himself. I think, here I am, 62 years old, and I can't even say War Eagle on my own car without a 4-year-old saying, no, 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 Alabama's number one. And that's what he ended up saying. Good, I'm just trying to make the difference, but this is such a heavy thing. Life has problems, life has pain. And so David's in this moment when he realizes that because of his past actions, he's now living in a present horrible story. He has prayed, he's begged God, he has fasted. And God chose not to answer David's prayers. Why? Why not? I don't know. That's a heavier than, that's a bigger question than I can answer. I don't know. Why did God take it out on a little baby? I don't know. That's the sovereign will of God. I don't know. Just tell you, I don't know. But something happened. So David says, they're whispering and talking to David, said, hey, is he dead? And they said, yeah. And immediately he got up and washed himself, changed his clothes. And the Bible says that he went to the house of God, even though he was wounded, even though he was weary, even though now he just worried. The Bible says David worshiped God. Wow. I mean, just like, boom. Soon as the baby's dead, most of us would weep after. He wept before. It's kind of interesting, isn't it? Most of us would pray more after. He prayed more before. And so the Bible says now that David got up. So let's read the Bible together. I'm going to give you 3 or 4 points here. We're going to go. So David arose from the ground, verse 20. He washed and anointed himself, and he changed his clothes, and immediately he went to the house. Now listen carefully. If we read the text, David didn't even eat food. From the time he got up, washed, cleansed himself, he went straight to the house of God. And the Bible says David worshipped. Wow. He worshipped. Wait a minute, Pastor, the baby's dead and his wife is grieving. I know. But David, I want you to notice this very much. In spite of all the circumstances that he himself had created and all that God decided to do sovereignly, to take a child's life, he's wounded, he's weary, he's worried. David trusted God. You need to catch this, church. Hey, Pastor, turn the TV on. It's a mess. I'm just telling you, guys, it's a mess. I don't know the answer. I have not heard one preacher say anything yet, but I'm a being. That's the answer. I've not heard one yet. Person, good advice. I've not heard one guy that I really felt like that and spoke the voice of God and said, this is what we need to do. So I'm going to tell you, when things are worrisome and weary and when you're wounded, the first thing you need to do is trust God. So look at David's advice. Not mine, David, verse 22. And he said, David, have you lost your mind? When all this is going on, you wept and you prayed and you fasted and now you're eating and worshiping? That is crazy. And David says in verse 22, while the child was alive, I fasted well, for I didn't know whether God would spare his life or not. That's what he says. Then he says, all I know to do, until the student, in this situation is to trust God. By the way, that's a pretty good thing to do, and all the church said, yes. I don't know some of the answers. Are we in a prophetic move of God right now? It sure seems like some things are kind of clouding up to come that way. And so what I'm telling you as a pastor, as a preacher of the gospel, number one, even when things are hard and difficult and you just want to cry out and say, God, why? Number one, you better trust God. David said, the reason I prayed was that I knew God would do what God would do, and I'm going to trust him with whatever he does. David trusted God. As difficult as it may be, as hard as it may be, I'm going to trust God. Somebody the other day, we were in a very intense conversation about what to do. And I was in Davis, I don't know what to get up and say. And they said, you know, right now, just might be quiet, just trust God. Because God knows what's going on. By the way, we better pray, he does, and all the church said. So David trusted God in this very difficult time. He worshiped. Now remember, worship is more than singing. It's more than raising your hands. That's all great. You love to do it. It's more than shouting to the Lord. It's more than bowing and praying. Worship is your heart and issue with the Lord. It's your heart saying to God, I trust you. I love you. I don't like the outcome of this situation. I don't like what's going on in my world. God, this is terrible. It's a mess. But Lord, at the end of the day, I trust you. There's no song, learning to lean. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. You better learn to lean in these days. I don't know when God will clear the smoke and we'll know what's going on, but I know this. David said, all I need to do is to pray and ask God and trust him that whatever is best, he would do, and God does know best. So he trusted God in his worship. Number two, not only do you trust God, but the Bible says he turned to God. Look at verse 23. Now, this is some great advice. I'll give one other that I didn't get a chance to give Miss Lisa. But now he's dead. So they said, David, he lost his mind. He said, well, I don't know what God was going to do. Is God going to save his life or spare his life? But if not, I just want you to know. But listen to this. David said, now he's dead. Why should I fast? He's dead. God's will is it. He took him home. That's all it's saying. Well, a lot of bad things out there right now. They're just going crazy. David said, can I bring you back? And the word there is known. He said, I'll just get ready to go to him. Wow. David trusted, but David turned his life over to God. And I think if I had a number, say here, would be, this is David's triumph. We love to sing victory in Jesus. His victory is he trusted, and in this very painful, problematic time in his life, he said, Lord, you're in control, and you know what's best. It's not what he asked for. It's not what he wanted, but he said, God, you know best. You know best. So God, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to turn to you. And I think that's where David really found his strength. By the way, matter of fact, we're talking about what worship does. Would you turn to Psalms 23 just for a moment, just real quick, like, turn on, let me show you something. Is as best I can tell, David wrote Psalm 23 after 2 Samuel. So David had gone through this experience. David had felt the pressure and the pain of what he went through. Now listen to what David said later. You know it. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. Now verse 3. And then he what? He restores my soul. So what is worship? Worship is the reason we're created. Worship is a response to God's goodness. But I'm going to tell you, worship will renew your spirit. It will restore you in situations that are painful and problematic and where you think God ought to do one thing, but God chooses to do another. And you say, Lord, I am going to trust you no matter. David goes on to say, since I can't bring you back, I'll just get ready to go be with you. That's victory. Amen. I love to say this. The older I got, I don't know if I'm getting you wise, but I know this. Death of the child of God is victory. Y'all do know that, right? In the last days, I would say this. I did a funeral with Miss Lola Derrick. She'd been a Christian over 60 years, and I told her family, this is the moment she's been living for. She spent her whole life being a Christian and serving God. And this is what she was living for, was to go see the Lord. And so David said, wisdom, and that's my last point, David's wisdom, I'm going to worship God because he knows what he's doing. Psalm 51, if you get a chance to read it, is David's repentant psalm. There's two of them in the Bible. But Psalm 51, he uses all three words for sin. God, I have sinned against you. And then we won't have time to read that. But in there, that moment, David simply says, restore the joy of my salvation. David realized God has a plan. The church, listen to me. How do you make sense of a pandemic? How do you feel calm in the midst of all this cultural confusion? Can I just say, crazy? The world has gone crazy. So what do we do? Do we panic? Do we throw our arms up? Or do we say, Lord, since I can't change this situation, your will be done. Since I can't bring him back, I will live in such a way that I will be with him. So I'm going to ask you this question clearly, and I want you to hear my heart. There's some things going on. I can't give you an answer. I can give you some speculation. But I don't know that God hadn't opened the prophetic door in the heavens, and there's some things going to happen that you and I can't stop. But I will say this. Even though it may not turn out the way we want it to, it doesn't mean that we can't say, Lord, you're God, and I don't trust you. So, Lord, your will be done. I tell you what, Luke, it will restore your shoulder. Realize you're not in control, but he is. I don't know about you, but aren't you glad? I believe. Here's my mind. Just for a moment. Mr. Ray said, thank you so much, saints. Pastor, I need a word. He's God. I need some clarification, Pastor. He's in control. They prayed that the child would live, but God struck him in that. You cannot ignore that fact in Scripture. It's not what David wanted. But David said, God's will be done. And he worshiped the Lord. Maybe you just right now need to say, Father God, I'm in a place where I don't want to be. I've done some things I wish I had done. Here I am. Lord, what can I do? David said, wisdom. Why don't you prepare your heart to me, God? Lord, forgive me. Lord, cleanse me. God, fill me with your Holy Spirit. Lord, restore my spirit. Renew my spirit. Changes this week. The airport is still closed down. So but they're going to be whatever moment that is, okay? But Mike, he is still going to Guatemala. He still will be working with CASA in a roundabout way right now until it works out full time. So he's going where he said he was. They just asked him to take a little time to get ready to do some things. So pray for him. So do that. Next Sunday morning, service times are what? 9 and 10:30. So we'll come a little bit, this service, you'll come a little bit early. So join a little bit early. The 8 o'clock service will join you, so there'll be a few more people in here. So please practice safe distancing. Make sure that you just, we can't make you do that, not, but please practice what you need to do to be safe to you and your family, okay? We can't help you do that. You need to do that for yourself. Hey, remind you, as you leave today, there's offering plates out there. Thank you for your faithfulness to give. We need you to continue to be faithful to do that. Hey, also, we have some leftover Mother and Father Day gifts. They're on the long counter out there. Please take those. Please go by and get one. Get one for your grandma and your niece and your aunt and your uncle. And if you got a cousin on the mom's side, just grab one. We got plenty. So we need to get rid of those things. Okay, so go by and do that if you would that. Hey, it's been good being in the house today. Amen. Hey, everybody, here's how we go. Brother Jim, you and your family stand, and you go out only the right door over here. Only the right.